what are the taxes that are replaced by GST regime, and are there any state level differences in GST rates depending either on the states or the type of product or service?
Yeah, so you know, let us go back 2 months back. Let us go 2 months back in the pre-GST era, as we say. So there were like this plethora of taxes for different activities. I will just share my screen over here. So yeah, so for manufacture we used to have excess duty for providing any services.
We cannot see the shared screen. Do you want us to see it?
Yeah.
In that case, you will have to click on screen share on the top. Is it now? Is it left second now? Yeah, perfect.
Yeah. So yeah, so in the pre-GST era, there were different kinds of taxes for different kind of activities. So for example, for excise duty, for manufacturing, we had excise duty. For services, we had service tax. And for sale of goods, we had VAT and CST, as they say. For import-export, we had custom duties. And for any transportation of, or for any entry of goods in a particular state, we had entry tax and octroi. Apart from this, there were also entertainment tax and all those stuff. So there were many taxes, and GST, it is understood, has replaced more than 20 indirect taxes. Local body taxes out now. And everything is now under one GST.
So we have central sales tax, excise duty, service tax. These are the major ones. And which others? Value added tax, of course.
Yeah. So entertainment tax.
Okay.
And all those taxes.
And in total, these are more than 20.
Yes. But then there are few taxes which are still remaining. So a lot of time I get questions, okay, now what are the indirect taxes apart from GST, which is still there? So basic custom duty is still there on imports. Stamp duty is still there on property. So property has been kept out of GST. So there will be no GST when you purchase a property. So you have to pay stamp duty. Then there is this profession tax, which the 2,500 rupees that we have to pay every year. It is deducted from your salary, or if you are a professional, you have to register with the respective state's profession tax department and pay 2,500 rupees. That is also still there.
Okay.
So few bunch of taxes are still there because a particular commodity is left out. For example, excise duty has not vanished.
Mm-hmm.
It is still applicable for petroleum products.
Okay. Alcohol?
So, same. Alcohol. So, it seems Abhyuday is very much keen to know about alcohol. So, alcohol is out of GST.
Okay.
But that does not mean that you don't have to pay tax on karna hai. You will still have to pay the state level tax that is, you know, applicable on alcohol for human consumption. But it will be still cheaper.
It will be cheaper?
It will be cheaper in Daman.
Okay, got it. But in those restaurant bills that you get when you order food and drinks, so that will be the state level tax, or there you have GST only for alcohol also?
No, so in the restaurant bill, whenever you get a restaurant bill, they are not supposed to tax GST, they are not supposed to charge GST on alcohol.
Okay.
So if they are doing so, they are doing it wrong.
Okay. So what are they supposed to charge on alcohol?
The respective state's excise duty.
Okay. Excise duty will be on the bottles, na, if you buy a bottle from a store. But if you buy alcohol in a shop, like you, or I mean in a Hard Rock cafe, let's say you consume a drink.
Correct.
Fair on that in the bill.
Yeah. So as alcohol, that the commodity is out of the purview of GST.
Okay.
It cannot be clubbed in that invoice.
All right. And state level VAT will not be there?
It will be there. As I said, that if it is not part of GST, it is part of different set of taxes.
Okay, got it.
So there will be state level VAT and excise.
Okay. Anything you'd like to share on the state level differences in the types of, or on the rate differences in GST on different types of products?
Yeah, so the biggest benefit of GST as of now in the present stage that it is that there will be uniform rate across all states. Initially, the rates used to differ from state to state. The VAT, VAT, value added tax, was a state subject. So every state had its own right to levy the rate it wants. But now, all commodities...
To levy, sorry. We just lost state, you for a second.
Huh. Yeah. So VAT was a state subject. So every state had a right to levy the rate that they are willing to levy. So, you know, for example, rates on mobile phones was less in Gujarat, but it was more in Maharashtra. So right. It was the prerogative of the state. But now in GST, everyone is under one roof.
Okay.
The rates are recommended by GST Council, and all the states are expected to accept and adapt that particular rate. So the biggest benefit, the business benefit, is that the rates are uniform across whole nation. But over here, so GST Council, as I said, can only recommend a rate. They cannot enforce a rate on a state. There is a provision in GST wherein a state can differ from a prescribed rate by 2%.
From the recommended rate?
Yes. No state has done this yet, but still this is a danger in future.
But so only differ by 2%, it's still not that much.
Yeah, but then the mechanism fails, right? The purpose fails.
Okay.
But because then everyone has to take care of all the respective state laws. So what was happening in the pre-GST regime was, if I was having an office at five states, I had to adhere to laws of five different states.
Right.
I was required to have five consultants because I don't know what is happening, what are the rules applicable in that particular state.
Right.
With GST, that is out.
Okay.
The set of provisions are applicable to whole country. So you did not worry about, you know, having different set of rules for different state.
Got it. Product wise, there is a difference in the rates, right? Because on some products, a higher level of GST is there, on some a lower.
Yeah. So over here now, let me before going to the rates, let me come to the structure of GST.
Yeah, sure. That makes sense.
Yeah, so it was, you know, said that it will be one tax, one nation, but unfortunately it is not so, and it is not possible to have that in a country like India. So what they have done is, we have got four levels of GST. I would like to share my screen over here once again. So is my screen on the visible?
Yes, perfectly.
Yeah.
So hey, GST, I had a request. You might want to check in your office whether they are giving you on one exclusive kind of Wi-Fi, so that from time to time there is a second or two where we miss your voice or the video quality goes down, so that can be improved. Just if you get a 5 seconds, you can just tell that in your office. So you have some dedicated bandwidth. Guys, just give us 10 seconds because we want to ensure that this session goes smoothly and we are able to see and hear everyone clearly.
Yeah,
thanks so much. Yeah, so let's look at the screen. Yeah.
So we were at structure of GST. So it has been said and it has been advertised widely.
You can't see the screen, huh?
It has been advertised very widely that it is a one nation, one tax. But actually, there are four different types of GST. And they are CGST, that is Central Goods and Service Tax, SGST, that is State Goods and Services Tax, Union Territory GST, that is Union Territory Goods and Services Tax, and then we have Integrated Goods and Services Tax, that is IGST.
All right.
So now in this case, when to levy what?
Yeah.
That is the next question. So what they say is, if you are having any transaction within a state, that is a intrastate transaction. Mm-hmm. So if I'm situated in Mumbai and I am providing a service to someone who is in Mumbai or someone who is in Pune, I will have to levy SGST and CGST.
All right.
But if I'm situated in Mumbai and I am providing services to someone who is in Delhi, then I will have to levy IGST. For union territories, there is once again a different act. So if I am situated somewhere in Daman and I am providing service to someone in Daman, then I will have to levy UTGST and CGST.
Okay.
As far as union territories are concerned, there is one thing which has to be noted, that for levying UTGST and CGST, there is an exception for Pondicherry and the am I visible now?
Yeah.
So as far as union territories are concerned, there is an exception for Delhi and Pondicherry.
All right.
So if you are transacting, if you are a service provider in Delhi, and if you are providing services to someone in Delhi, you will still levy SGST and CGST.
Got it.
Although Delhi and Pondicherry are union territories, there is this exception carved out for these two union territories.
Right. And what if you are providing services from Daman to, say, Mumbai, Gujarat?
Then the service provider will have to levy IGST. So any transaction outside a state or outside a union territory, IGST is supposed to be levied.
Plus any other tax or just the IGST?
No, just the IGST.
So if it is Delhi, Mumbai also, then it is just IGST?
It is just IGST. There is a cess.
Okay.
Over and above this normal taxes, but that is for a product. That is product wise. So if you buy any luxury car, then you have to pay cess over and above the normal tax.
Mm-hmm.
But that depends on the product. It has nothing to do with the location of the service provider.
Okay.
So this was the structure of the taxes in GST. Now let us come to rates. As you had pointed out, it is once again, so it is not that it is one tax, one nation when it comes to the structure, because we have got four different types of GSTs. Now, if we come to rates over here also, it is not that it is one tax, one nation, because we have got different slabs. They are 0%, 5%, 12%, 18%, and 28%.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, we have few products wherein we will have to levy a cess. So that is like 28% plus cess.
Mm-hmm.
And after GST got implemented, there were two new rates which came in for very specific products. That was 3%, and then that was 0.25%.
Okay.
So now, in all, we have got the 7 different kinds of rates plus a cess.
All right.
So that was about the rates. Now, if we come to the point that who is supposed to pay GST or who is supposed to get registered under GST.
Mm-hmm.
So all those providers, whether goods or services, if your turnover is more than rupees 20 lakhs, then you are liable to get registered under GST. I would like to share my screen over here once again. So there is some kind of standardization over here as well, vis-a-vis the pre-GST regime. Wherein in pre-GST regime, if you are a manufacturer and if your turnover is crossing 1.5 CR, you have to register under excise. If you are a service provider, and if your turnover is more than 10 lakhs, you have to register under service tax. And if you are into trading, then and if your turnover was above 5 lakhs in some states and about 10 lakhs in some states, then you have to register under VAT. And just in case, if you are also a manufacturer and also a service provider and also into trading, you have to register under all three laws. In GST, now it is fairly simple. If your turnover is crossing 20 lakhs, you have to register under GST.
Yeah.
For few specific states, the limit is 10 lakhs, which is basically Northeast states plus Himachal Pradesh and Jammu and Kashmir. So if you are someone in that state, you have to register under GST if your turnover is crossing 10 lakhs. And for other states, you have to register under GST if your turnover is crossing 20 lakhs.
Got it.
Now, a lot of time I get questions regarding registrations is, what if my turnover is, my turnover is about 20 lakhs, but 15 lakhs of the turnover is for exempt items. And 10 lakhs of my turnover is for taxable items. Let us take a very simple example of someone who is dealing into dairy products. So milk is exempt, or it is into nil rate. So let us say there is this Doodhwala who is selling milk, and his turnover for selling milk is 15 lakhs. But he is also selling Amul ice cream.
Right.
Which we generally do in dairies, and the turnover for that is 10 lakhs.
All right.
So he has to pay tax on only 10 lakhs. But as the aggregate taxable turnover, aggregate turnover is going beyond 20 lakhs, he still has to register.
And he has to pay on the amount that is?
That is taxable.
But the exemption is still 20 lakhs, so it should be only on 5 lakhs.
No. So it is not like that.
Okay.
If you are registered, you have to pay the tax.
And if you are not registered, then it's fine. Okay.
So earlier, in service tax regime, there was this provision, of small service provider exemption, wherein although you have registered, but if your turnover was less than 10 lakhs in the previous financial year, you are not required to pay the tax.
Correct.
That concept is not there in GST.
So now, if it's less than 20, you don't register. And if you register for less than 20 also, you have to pay.
Yes, you have to pay the tax for the taxable commodity that you are taking.
Got it.
Another thing for GST is that it is completely decentralized. So in service tax, it was fine if you are taking only one registration for whole country. You are getting only one registration number.
Correct.
But in GST, you have to take a state-wise registration. The turnover over here will be calculated on the basis of your PAN. So to give you an example, let us say I am a service provider and I am having an office in Maharashtra as well and in Pune, in Maharashtra as well and also in Gujarat. So my turnover or my billing from Maharashtra is, let us say, is 30 lakhs. So fair enough, I have to take the registration as my turnover is crossing 20 lakhs. But my billing from Gujarat is only of 5 lakhs rupees. As per provisions of GST law, still I need to take registration in Gujarat, because aggregate turnover on my PAN card that is in 30 lakhs in Maharashtra and 5 lakhs in Gujarat is 35 lakhs, which is above 20 lakhs. So the person has to take the registration in every state from where he is providing services or taxable supplies, as we say.
Right.
So registration has to be taken in each and every state.
So first step is to look at the aggregate turnover, and if it's crossing the taxability threshold, then you have to obtain registration in every state where you are providing the service.
Correct.
Okay.
Now, a lot of time also get questions regarding, okay, you say that you have to take registration in every state, but what if there is a state wherein I'm having my office, but I'm not providing any service from them?
Mm-hmm.
I'm not, billing anything from there. So what should I do in that case?
You have zero turnover from that office?
Yes. So in that case, you are not required to take the registration.
Because then you're not providing service. You might be receiving services from other consultants.
Yes, yes.
But if you are receiving services from other consultants, you might want to obtain credits and stuff.
So while deciding whether you want to take the registration or not, one has to consider, one, if there is any outward taxable supply, that is, if you are doing anything, you're
sorry, we are not able to hear you. There was a slight disruption in the internet. Yeah.
Okay. So while taking a decision whether I need to take a registration in particular state or not, you have to consider whether you are doing any billing from there. If yes, you are mandatorily required to take the registration. If not, you have to see how much is your credit loss in that state.
Right.
You need to do a cost-benefit analysis. It should not happen that the compliance cost is more than the credit that you are getting over there. So that is because the compliance is so huge that most probably you will have to employ one person over there to take care of all this thing.
Got it.
So that is a business decision that one has to take.
But one thing is clear, that if you are claiming credit in one state, then you need to have a registration.
Yes.
Got it.
Now, apart from this turnover limits, there are certain specific people or there are certain transactions that if you want to undertake, you have to mandatorily register. One of the most prominent ones is if you are doing any interstate supply. That means if I wish to sell any goods, if I am in Maharashtra and if I wish to sell any goods out of Maharashtra, I am mandatorily required to take a registration, even if that sale is for 1 lakh.
Even if I have an aggregate turnover of less than 20 lakh?
Yes. So if you wish to provide any service or any goods, which is an interstate transaction, that is out of your home state, you are mandatorily required to take a registration.
We lost you, Jigar.
Hello?
Yeah, everything got stuck. That if you wish to provide any services outside of your, or products outside of your home state, in that case, what happens?
In that case, you are mandatorily required to take the registration, even if your turnover is less than 20 lakhs.
Then I'll have to pay the tax also if I obtain the registration.
Yeah, you have to charge and you have to pay the tax and you also have to follow all compliances.
So if I am an interstate provider of goods and services, then the 20 lakh threshold has no relevance for me?
No relevance.
Only if I'm a local state level supplier within my state I'm operating, then only it will be having a use.
Yeah. Yes.
So mostly in online businesses where you're selling across India, your 20 lakh threshold goes out of the window.
GST registration. Yes. And then there is a specific provision for the online vendors. So first of all, if you are an e-commerce operator, that is, if you are into something which is a marketplace, you are mandatorily required to take the registration.
Right.
Even if your turnover is 1 rupees or 10 rupees, once again, 20 lakhs threshold does not matter.
Right.
Second, if you are any person who is supplying through an e-commerce operator, you are once again required to take a registration. Now, there are certain complexities over here. So someone, you know, people ask me whenever I talk about this point, ki apna quicker or OLX ka kya hoga? Anyone who wants to sell, you know, mera purana ye bechna hai, mere ko laptop bechna hai, car, you know, bike bechna hai, so will I have to take the registration? So answer over here is no. We have to read the law carefully, which says that registration will have to be taken all those vendors who are supplying through e-commerce portal on which TCS provisions are applicable.
What is TCS?
TCS provisions are tax collection at source provisions.
Okay.
Wherein the e-commerce operator, that is the platform, will collect 1% of TCS for every transaction done through them. But this will be done for only taxable transactions. So let us say, if I am into business of laptops, I have a shop and I am selling through a e-commerce portal, I am selling through Flipkart. Okay. So once the first thing is I am mandatorily required to register. Flipkart is mandatorily required to register. Whenever I sell it for 50,000, Flipkart will collect the amount and right. Flipkart will deduct 500 rupees as tax.
This is income tax law, tax collection at source provision, right?
Similar 1%. To that, but this is not income tax.
This is not.
This is
okay.
GST.
GST tax collection at source.
Yeah. So income tax is governed by direct tax, Income Tax Act 1961. GST is governed by GST laws. So they are two separate acts.
Correct.
So, but this TCS is under GST. You will get the credit for TCS when you are going to pay GST and not when you are going to pay income tax.
Yeah, got it.
So the point that I wanted to make was this provisions will be applicable only when the supply that vendor is doing is a taxable supply. When someone is transacting through Quikr and OLX, that person is not into business of selling things, right?
Yes.
So that falls out of the definition of supply itself.
Got it.
So TCS provisions and registration will not be required if you are selling anything through Quikr or OLX.
Okay. What if there is like a design, there's a marketplace where let's say a lot of designers are there, okay? And so people who want to, or where you can hire freelancers from. So someone who wants to commission a design project says that this is my requirement. This is a software design kind of project, UI or UX design kind of thing. So the buyer says that this is what I want. And there are 10 people who bid for it and one person gets it. Now this person is going to get the money. So TCS, GST, everything will be applicable on this, right?
Everything will be applicable in this case.
And if it was a royalty that these people were getting, even then it will be applicable.
Well, then we need to see at the transaction. So this provisions are applicable only if there is a marketplace.
So what if there was a marketplace where there were there are many such, like, you know, you have Udemy, for example. Udemy has, imagine now if something like Udemy is there in India and there are many course creators who've created courses and they are earning a royalty from the courses. Okay, now in this situation, would this apply?
So over here, now there are two things that you need to see.
Okay.
So for example, Udemy.
Yeah.
So what happens in Udemy, and this is my understanding is let us say I am someone who wants to teach. So I will just register myself. It is a marketplace and whoever wants to enroll for the course, they will enroll and they will pay me.
Yeah.
If this is the transaction, GST and TCS will be applicable.
Yeah. Now Udemy pays a royalty to the person who created the course based on these sales.
Correct. So GST will be applicable. But let us say now there is someone like what is the name of that app, education ke liye, which is very popular.
Which one? There are many.
वो पाइथागोरस वाला एडवर्टाइजमेंट आता है
बायजूस
हां बायजूस हां सो नाउ बायजूस इज नॉट अ मार्केट प्लेस
या
व्हाट बायजूस इज डूइंग इज दैट द प्रोडक्ट इट इज अ प्रोडक्ट ऑफ द ऑफ बायजूस राइट
या
इट इज नॉट अ मार्केट प्लेस सो इन दिस केस इट इज नॉट अ ई-कॉमर्स वेबसाइट
या
इट इज प्रोवाइडिंग द सर्विसेज ऑन इट्स ओन नेम
करेक्ट
So over here, GST and TCS provisions will not be applicable.
Got it.
So you have to distinguish it accordingly.
Right. Hmm. Understood.
Now let us see. Is it fine if I take you through the portal, GST portal for the registration?
Yeah, that will be lovely. That will be lovely.
Yeah. So I'm just sharing the screen. So first of all, it is very easy. but the website, you know, it gives some problems. So this is the website, www.gst.gov.in.
Right.
So if I am doing it for the first time, I am a taxpayer normal and I have to register now.
Right.
So over here, when I'm doing it for the first time, I will have to just fill up this basic information, which is who am I? I'm a taxpayer or GST state, district, my name, PAN number, etc.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Once I do this process, I will get a TRN number.
All right.
On my email ID. From next time onwards, when I'm logging in, I have to use this TRN number. So I have already generated a TRN number. I am using that.
Okay.
So you get an OTP now. OTP is received on your email as well as mobile number.
Right.
Waiting for OTP.
Yeah,
I have received it. This OTP is valid only for 10 minutes.
All right.
Once I enter, I have this screen, and then I have to take appropriate actions.
Okay.
So this is the dashboard.
Achha.
So I have to give my trade name, what is my constitution of business. This is just a dummy. I have to give this information, Mumbai, all those stuff, commissioner code.
Is that easy to find? Your applicable division code.
This is not easy to find.
Achha.
This is not easy to find. They have given us this link, but this is like, huge. This is the link.
Okay.
You have to just find out. From concept state mein there ho, you have to do that.
Okay.
And then you also have to find this commissionerate code, etc. So this is a little painful.
Okay.
But if you are already registered, under service tax, then this should be easily available to you. You have to use the same thing.
Right.
Now you also have to give reason for obtaining. So let us say if I am saying that it is crossing the threshold limit. This is just a dummy data I am entering. Accordingly, then you have to move ahead. So this is the next screen.
Okay.
This is for, so I'm done with my business details. So I will get a tick over here. And there is this also percentage over here, how much I am done.
Super.
So then I have to give my basic details, my date of birth, and this should match with my PAN card.
Right.
My name and my date of birth should match with my PAN card. Otherwise, it will throw an error. After you are done with the registration, you will get a validation error.
Okay.
I have to give my basic details over here. Then I'm also required to upload my photograph. So the best thing over here is that you can also take a selfie. You just have to take picture. You will, you know, you can just click it, then you are done.
Lovely.
And if you want to upload it, it has to be less than 100 KB.
Right.
The file should be less than 100 KB. Then it might so happen that I have, you know, assume that I'm a very busy person and I don't have time to, you know, do my compliances. So I can authorize someone else to do it. So I can give details of my authorized signatory. So this generally happens in companies and LLPs and all those places where, you know, the manager is authorized to do all the compliance.
Yeah.
You have to give proof of that. That is, you will require a letter of authority or a board resolution. But you also have to give a photograph of that particular person.
Yeah.
After that, this is authorized representative. Let us say if you have a consultant, a chartered accountant to whom you are entrusting him with the responsibility for filings. You have to get that person registered over here.
Right.
So if there is any chartered accountant who says that I will do your GST compliance, you have to take enrollment ID from him.
Okay. And what is GST practitioner? Then, who all can be GST practitioners?
Chartered accountants can be GST practitioners. And so company secretary, lawyers.
Okay.
All those people. Cool. Then you have got this. After that, details of your principal place of business. So where your business is actually registered. Over here, you will have to give what is the nature of possession. Have you taken someone's consent? So काफी बार ऐसा होता है, you know, कि जो पेरेंट्स होते हैं वो ही अपना जगह दे देते हैं बच्चों को कि चलो तुम बिजनेस करो अपना. सो वी डोंट पे एक्चुअली रेंट टू देम. सो वी हैव टू टेक दिस लेटर ऑफ कंसेंट फ्रॉम देम दैट इट इज ओके, आई एम डूइंग, आई एम गिविंग. देन
इफ इट इज परपस आल्सो यू हैव टू अपलोड दैट लेटर.
यस यस.
अरे हां, प्रूफ ऑफ
प्रिंसिपल. सो इफ यू कंसेंट,
ओके,
द दिस थिंग विल ओपन अप. व्हाट आर द डॉक्यूमेंटेशन दैट आई हैव टू गिव?
गॉट इट.
I have to give consent letter or bill or this or this.
Yeah.
But if it is owned, then this list will change.
Yeah.
Accordingly, I have to upload a file which should be less than 1 MB.
Yeah.
Then you also have to disclose your nature of business activity. The service provider. No, you have to select one of this.
Yeah.
After that, let us say you also have an additional place of business in the same state. So you have to do it yes over here and give details for additional place of business over here. Once you are done with that, you have to disclose you are dealing in what, on what goods and services.
So HSN is a 6-digit code, na? This is there in import export also.
Yeah, and HSN is an 8-digit code.
Eight digit, okay.
Okay. So Actually, HSN is an 8-digit code, but as of now, they are showing only 4 digits to make it simpler.
Yeah, okay.
The funny part is the codes for this thing, services, are not yet updated.
They're not there only.
Yeah, they are not updated in GST portal. So you have to use the same codes that you were using in service tax regime.
Okay. Tricky.
And you have to specify top 5 commodities. It is not that you have to specify all commodities.
So you have to do comma, 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 or what?
No, no. So let us say I do this. I also get a drop down list.
Yeah. So oh, like that. Yeah. Okay, okay.
So then you accordingly have to add.
Got it.
The UI is very good.
Yeah. This is the one of the first cloud-based UIs, it seems, because yeah. MCA is on PDF you have to upload. So it's not exactly, you're not filling forms on the cloud.
Correct. Then bank account details is what you are required to give. IFSC. Over here also you have to give proof of your bank account. So yeah. Either you can give a bank statement or a cancel check.
Mm-hmm.
State specific information, PTEC number or PTRC number is something that you have to give over here. State excise license number, this is for petroleum and alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And then final verification. So I have not filled in any details for authorized signatories. So once I do that, I will get a drop down over here. Place. Then you have an option to sign it with DSC or e-signature or EVC.
What is EVC?
EVC is this thing. You will get an OTP over here.
Okay. And which e-signatures is it accepting?
As of now, this is e-mudra.
E-mudra. And DSC to sare 6-7 companies hain.
Yes. So yeah, this is it, and then you are done. But a lot of people are facing issues when they are trying to sign with DSC. There is a lot of lot of requirements and configuration and downloads that you have to do to make it work.
Okay.
So it is quite complex for chartered accountants.
Okay.
So a lot of people are facing issues with this, and also once you have filed. This thing, then there is this validation error which is appearing
okay.
for many people. That is because of PAN mismatch.
Hmm.
So the error is
why is that happening? Because they are putting their actual PAN.
No, so it is quite funny. So what is happening is that during last week of July, and the first week of August, there was huge load on income tax website,
right,
for IT return filings, and they verify this PAN card through that income tax website.
Correct.
Some issue over there, that is why they were not able to capture that data. So error was like that PAN does not exist even though it was existing. So
yeah, I've heard of
those
this.
Are the complications.
And the support team is not responding fast enough on these.
Yeah, so there are a lot of technology challenges. I don't know where the figure that is that every month there will be 3.5 billion invoices which will be uploaded on the system. I don't know from the past experience how much the system will be able to take it.
Okay.
So that is going to be a challenge. Technology is going to be a huge challenge. And it is also an opportunity for entrepreneurs over here, young entrepreneurs. If one can provide a good solution to anyone.
Right.
If only that can happen.
Okay. There is a doubt that one student has asked. His name is Aditya. He said that what is the scenario for the medicines or the pharmaceutical industry? He's saying that he has a medicine provider who deducted 20% discount on the MRP and then charge GST on the discounted amount. And he's asking, is MRP inclusive of GST or not?
Yeah. So MRP is always inclusive of all taxes. And the dealer has rightly done. He has levied the tax on the transaction value. So let us say MRP is 100 rupees, but my transaction value is 70 rupees. Then tax is supposed to be levied only on that 70 rupees.
Mm-hmm.
But the shop owner will not be able to levy GST on 100 rupees MRP. So it should never be 100 rupees MRP plus GST. It will always be inclusive of GST.
Okay.
If anyone is charging GST over and above MRP, it is not as per law.
But how would you say, like, which law? Because it would be only against the manufacturer's instruction or the distribution chain's instruction, right? Or there is otherwise no regulation on the MRP?
No, there is a legal metrology act.
The metrology, okay. But is that specifying that MRP is total, includes the indirect tax charge on it?
Yes. It has to be inclusive.
Okay.
It has to be inclusive.
Got it. So, okay, we've gone through the steps in the registration. Consequences of non-registration, something we'd like to discuss, especially now when there are so many errors coming on the site. So what should people do? Both aspects we'd like to know from you.
Yeah. So how much time do we have?
We were planning till 4, but if it goes for another 15-20 minutes beyond 4, if you're okay, then we can continue.
Yeah, I'm absolutely fine.
So we can continue till 4:20. 4:20.
I hope everyone else is awake.
People are enjoying, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah, and if any of you have doubts, feel free to send us your doubts. You can WhatsApp me on 9717301797. Or you can even message Komal. She had put her number, I think, in the email. Yeah, go on.
Now, what if we don't take registration? So first and foremost, is that now in GST, the person who is compliant will be rewarded. Earlier in the pre-GST era, those who are not compliant were at benefit. Yes. So let us say if I am someone who is just dealing in cash. Okay. So obviously my rates will be cheaper than the one who is registered and who is paying taxes.
Correct.
So what was happening is that those who are non-compliant were getting rewarded.
Correct.
But in GST system, it has completely changed. Because of only one provision, which was like a master stroke, you know, and which came at a fag end.
Okay.
And that provision is this section 9.4, which says that if any registered person buys from any unregistered person, he is required to pay tax under reverse charge mechanism.
Right.
So I will like to give a brief about reverse charge mechanism. This was there in service tax. So generally what happens is, let us say I'm a service provider and if I'm billing something to you. So if the bill amount is 1 lakh, I will be billing 1 lakh plus 18% GST and I will give you bill of 1,18,000. You will pay me 1,18,000. 1 lakh will go into my pocket. 18,000 will be paid to government. This is forward charge. Yeah, this is forward charge.
Can you repeat the example? This is a invoicing scenario.
Yeah, proper invoicing scenario.
Okay.
Which is also known as forward charge. Now in reverse charge, what happens is that I am someone whose service is under reverse charge. Let us say advocates. Their services are under reverse charge. So if I am billing something to you of rupees 1 lakh, I will bill only for 1 lakh. I will not levy any GST on that. Now you are the service recipient. You are supposed to pay 1 lakh to me. Now you are supposed to determine what is the tax on this 1 lakh? So if you determine it is 18%, now the onus is on you to pay that tax to the government as a service recipient. This mechanism is known as reverse charge mechanism.
Right.
So now, if there is any registered person who is having GST number, and if he is buying anything from an unregistered number, person who is not having GST number, he is required to pay the tax on it to the government on his home. So first, he has to determine what is the SSC code for the services or goods that he has bought, what is the rate applicable to it, and also make the payment to the government. So buying from unregistered dealer is very cumbersome. Most of
unregistered our clients, provision applies only to people who would have been required to register and have not registered, because there will be many dealers who have a smaller turnover and all.
No, it is applicable to every unregistered dealer. So even your panwala
below the threshold also.
Yes.
So that guy will be exempted, but the person who's taking services from him will have to pay in reverse charge mechanism.
Yes.
Achha, what will happen if there are startups and if they, when they have a small size, small team size, at that time they have people on consultancy agreements. They may not have people on their roles as employees. Okay. So how does that work? Because the startup is the recipient of a service if you have a consultancy agreement.
Correct.
And the employee, since it's a recipient, the individual employee will be exempted from registration. The individual, sorry, not.
Correct. And is the startup registered? Hello.
Yeah, what happened? Huh? Okay, internet is back. Theek hai. Yeah, hello. Sorry, guys, there was a disruption. We are back. Jigar, can you hear me?
Yeah, so you were talking about a startup.
I was talking about arrangements in early stage startups where they hire people on a consultancy agreement basis. And then the startup is the recipient of services. So it's not required to normally register. And the consultant might be earning less than 20 lakhs a year. So then they also don't need to pay individual GST because they will be under the 20 lakh limit. But now what happens? Does the reverse charge mechanism apply here?
No. Over here it will not apply because both the provider and receiver, both are unregistered.
No, the startup might have a 20 lakh turnover.
So if the startup is registered and it is having, or it does not matter if it is having 20 lakh turnover or not. But if the startup is registered, it has to pay the tax under reverse charge.
Okay. And on consultancy agreements, so this will be applicable then. But it will not be applicable in employment relationship.
No. So GST is not to be levied on salaries and all.
Right, but consultancy fees, it will be levied.
Yeah.
Got it.
So there is one more thing over here. This was about section 9.4, where reverse charge is applicable. This is like a blanket provision, wherein if you take any service from an unregistered dealer, you have to pay tax under reverse charge. There is one more section, right, which has listed down few services on which RCM has to be paid mandatorily.
Reverse charge mechanism. RCM is what? Two. We're having internet issues. Hello, you can see me? Can you see me, Jigar?
Yeah, my connection is moving over here. I can see myself moving.
जबरदस्ती रिस्टार्ट मत करना प्लीज।
या वी बैक या जिगर
आर वी बैक
या वी आर बैक
या
सो यू वर टेलिंग अस अबाउट द रिवर्स चार्ज मैकेनिज्म.
Yes. So apart from dealings from unregistered dealer, there are few specific services wherein even if you are buying or taking that services from a registered dealer, you have to pay the tax under reverse charge. For example, goods transport agency, services from a lawyer, etc. So taking an example of a startup, let us say that there is a startup whose turnover is less than 20 lakhs.
Correct.
Or this startup is a registered company. Its turnover is less than 20 lakhs. So it is not required to take the registration on the basis of threshold limit. But if it takes any service from an advocate or a lawyer, I think it has paused once again.
It is
hello. Hello. Hello.
Hi Jigar, we're having fluctuations here with the internet.
So is it from your end, my or but does the broadcast stops?
The broadcast will freeze when I am off the connection.
Got it.
I'm back, guys. Sorry about the interruption. Yeah, Jigar, please continue.
So there are few. So we were into an example. There is a startup whose turnover is less than 20 lakhs and it is not registered. Now, if it is taking any service from a lawyer or an advocate, it has to register under service tax, under GST, and pay the tax under reverse charge.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
If there is any startup which is taking a service from advocates, or if it is importing any service, or is it taking services of a goods transport agency, it has to mandatorily register itself and do all GST compliance.
If it is, it has to cross that eligibility threshold, 20 lakhs threshold.
That does not matter.
In which circumstances it doesn't matter?
When the startup is taking services from an advocate, or is importing any service, or is taking services from a goods transport agent.
These three situations specifically?
These three and many more.
Okay, okay. Which section is this?
This is a notification wherein they have listed down services which are under reverse charge mechanism. Section is 9.3.
Okay.
It's flowing through 9.3.
In which case they will have to pay only on these under reverse charge mechanism, or once they register, then every other thing that they are doing becomes leviable to GST.
So once you are registered, then you are a then the whole thing comes.
It's like that.
Yeah.
So startups should not consult lawyers ever. Because then they'll have to pay GST on every goddamn thing that they're doing.
But you can definitely, you can always take a credit of it. So it is not a financial loss, but then there is a lot of compliance and working capital blockage for 1 month.
In which case?
In this RCM case.
What basically the tax that you've paid that gets blocked for the first month because you're not getting credit, and the credit will start flowing in the next few months.
Next month. Yes.
Got it.
So first you have to discharge your liability in cash, and you can take a credit afterwards in the next month.
Yeah. And is there now, okay, so we've completed all the consequences of non-registration. Is there anything you want to share about softwares or existing systems, how they need to be changed, what you have been coming across while working with clients?
Yeah, so as far as larger clients are concerned, with turnover of more than 500 CR, so they are having this ERP systems and SAP, Oracle. So that has been a long process, huge process. A lot of changes are required to be done, especially in the finance module, even in the procurement module and the sales module. So technologically, as far as systems goes, there is a huge change which is to be done in a large setup. Okay, so there were like specific consultants only for this purpose. Companies like SAP has created a product for this. And a lot of people have created a product. We say that they are ASPs, application service providers. They have created this product. So I'm a consultant for one of the ASPs, that is sahigst.com. Mm-hmm. So they have created a product for GST compliance.
Yeah.
So you need to, there are changes, one, in your accounting that you need to configure in your system. So even if you are having something like tally, you need to update your masters, you need to update your ledgers, then you need to change your accounting in such a way that you get an appropriate report for filing GST returns. So this is something where you will definitely need some additional help. So your chartered accountant will be the best person to help you out in setting this up. But this is one time activity that everyone has to do. So once accounting is set, then for filing of returns, we have got this ASPs, like we have got say GST, we have got clear tax, etc. We have also got utility of government, which is available free.
Yeah.
You can use that as well for filing of returns. You can also update your data on the government's portal itself, but then it is very time consuming and not recommended.
Okay.
So these are the changes that you need to do for that aspect.
Got it.
So I was also planning to show
books and all these accounting softwares have a GST addition now, the cloud-based accounting software. Yes. So that should be fine, right?
Yes, yes. So in QuickBooks specifically, you can raise a GST invoice. That is not an issue.
Yeah.
But you cannot file returns through QuickBooks.
Correct.
You have to extract data from QuickBooks and you know, put that data in some another format and then file the return.
Correct. Yeah, you were mentioning you wanted to show something.
Yeah, so I wanted to show GST invoice, how it should look.
Actually, the day it became levied every day, I was in Calcutta that day and people were really talking about it. Every restaurant, they got a GST bill and they were like, hey, this is my bill.
Yeah, selfies and all with GST.
Yeah.
So this is a GST invoice. Okay.
What is unique about it, except for those three lines?
So few important things like GST number of the supplier.
Right.
The invoice number. Invoice number should not be of more than 15 digits.
Achha.
And you cannot use any special characters except the slash and a hash.
Okay.
So yeah, 17-18 ka jo ye hai, this is fine. This is fine, but I cannot use at the rate.
Yeah, got it.
So that is as per law. Yes, GST number of the receiver.
Right.
Okay. The state code of the receiver.
Right.
Place of supply. Whether RCM is applicable or not.
Okay.
So you have to specifically mention that it is not applicable in this case. There is this SSE number, that SAC code number that you have to do.
Where is that? What is SSE?
So everyone is mandatorily required to disclose SSE or HSN. So if you are dealing in goods, you are required to disclose HSN code. And if you are dealing in services, you are required to disclose SSE codes.
This is the part that is not updated, you said, in the registration portal.
Yeah, the SSE is not updated, HSN is updated.
Okay.
So there is this limit, there are this threshold. So if your turnover is from 0 to 1.5 CR, you are not required to disclose SSE, it is fine, or HSN.
Okay.
If your turnover is between 1.5 CR to 5 CR, you are required to disclose 2-digit HSN code. And if your turnover is beyond 5 CR, you are required to disclose 4-digit HSN code. So these are mandatory provisions as far as SSE code and HSN codes goes. And yeah, so this is the unique part about it. SAC, place of supply, and RCM.
Right.
So this is a complete invoice.
Got it.
So this is how your invoice should
and
look.
These codes have to be disclosed in the invoice itself to everyone if
yes, yes.
Turn over.
Yeah.
There's a penalty on not having an invoice as per GST?
There is no penalty as such.
Hmm.
It is fine because this is just a procedural lapse.
Yeah.
You can always fight it out.
Okay.
After that, I wanted to show the payment process.
Yeah, that would be lovely. So we'll have the registration, the invoice, and the payment process covered.
Yes. So once again, I will go to gst.gov.in. Now I will log in. So I'm logging in through my firm's ID because this is the registration process for this is done. So in payment, one thing is required to be considered is that if you make the payment on counter, it will be reflected. So if you go to a bank and then make a payment,
yeah,
so it will be reflected only after one day. So it is okay. Like this T plus one concept.
Yeah.
So this is the dashboard that you will get after your registration process is complete.
Right.
So let us say I want to make a payment. So what I will do is I will create challan. I will put the tax like this 10 rupees.
Right.
I have this three options: e-payment, over the counter, NEFT, RTGS.
Uh-huh.
So if I do e-payment, it will be real time.
Okay.
So the amount will be reflected in my cash ledger as soon as I do the payment. But if I do it over the counter or NEFT, RTGS, it will be T plus one.
All right. Does this have a practical significance?
Yes. Yeah, because if you want to file your GSTR3, that is GST return, the challan, the payment that you have done is supposed to be reflected in your cash ledger.
Okay.
So if you do it over the counter, that process will be that process will get postponed.
Does it mean that the person should pay one day before?
Yeah, you have to pay at least 2 days before.
Okay, before the deadline, so that this is reflected. Yeah.
Yes, if you are doing it over the counter or NEFT RTGS. So I'll do it payment mode, generate challan. So my challan will be generated. I have selected e-payment. Once again, e-payment. I will select the bank. So these are the only banks which are eligible to take the payment. So one has to be careful whether you are having bank accounts in one of these banks or not.
Yeah, okay.
Terms and conditions, which we never read. And then make payment. And then it will take you to your respective bank accounts website.
Okay.
So from over there, you need to complete the process. So once you have done the payment, it should then reflect over here in payments. You will get a challan history.
Wow.
of the payments that you have done.
Okay.
Okay. Failed, paid. So we were trying all these things.
Okay. Got it.
So you can search it by CPIN. You can search it by date.
What is CPIN?
And you've got saved. So see, just a minute. So when we created that challan, we got this reference number.
Achha.
That is CPIN.
Got it.
So this is what we just created.
For each challan, you get a CPIN?
Yes. So this is just what we created. This was our CPIN. This is what we did right now.
Yeah.
1617. After that, once it is done, let me see if I have done any successful payments. It has to reflect in your electronic cash ledger. So yeah, we made payment of 4 rupees today, which is reflected in my cash ledger.
Why is it called an electronic cash ledger? It has no connection with your actual accounting books.
No, like this is a book which is being maintained by the department. So my accounting book should tally with this thing.
Yeah.
So my cash balance is 4 rupees. IGST is 1, CGST is 1, SGST is 1, CS is 1.
Balance meaning?
So we made 4 rupees ka payment, right?
Yeah. So that's what is there.
Yeah. So if I utilize it, it will reduce.
No, so you have paid this without connecting it with a taxable service, yeah, just to try out a payment.
Yes. So when I will file my GSTR3, when I will file my GSTR3, it will get utilized.
Okay.
So this is my ledger.
Okay.
So I've deposited this amount. So I've got 4 rupees to utilize. So this is like my Paytm account.
Yeah.
I got my 4 rupees. Now, whenever my liability will arise, I will utilize this 4 rupees.
Yeah. But mostly people won't pay in advance, na?
No. So yes, mostly people will not pay in advance. But first, they have to pay it. It has to reflect in this ledger, and then it will be attributed to your liability through GSTR3.
Hear you. Sorry. Can you please repeat? We couldn't hear you.
So you will have to make the payment. Mm-hmm. It has to first reflect over here.
Right.
So if you're doing it through over the counter, it will get reflected over here after 2 days.
Right.
Once it is reflected over here, then you can utilize it for paying off your tax liability.
Right. And if you've claimed credit, then also a credit balance can show here.
So that balance will be reflected in your electronic credit ledger.
So this is your cash ledger. Okay.
This is electronic cash ledger. Let us go to electronic credit ledger.
Achha, tell me something. So I may, so if I keep getting GST invoices from people and I've kept on paying it, so I should keep uploading it there, right?
Yes. This is electronic credit ledger, similar to the cash ledger. So if you have uploaded anything, it will be reflected over here.
Okay. Got it.
So this was the payment process. Any questions?
There was one question. I'll just tell you. Is GST applicable for someone who is into online knowledge services, like selling case studies online to different B schools across the world?
If your turnover is more than 20 lakhs.
Okay. Got it. All right. Yeah. That was the question from Mohan Chandran. Now, so how to obtain input tax credit? Also, we have on what kinds of expenses is credit available?
So we should see on what kind of expenses credit is not available.
Okay.
So credit is available for all your expenses, which they say are for furtherance of your business.
Okay.
So any expense that you do for your business, you get the credit. This is the blanket rule. But you don't get credit for Ola Uber, that is rent a cab services. You don't credit for restaurants. You don't get credit for outdoor catering. You don't get credit for beauty treatment. Yeah, this is a major expense for film stars.
They won't get credit. Get credit for this. Okay.
No, although it is for their business, they don't get credit.
Okay.
Even like something like catering, there are a lot of companies which provide food to their employees.
Yeah.
So credit is not available over there to them.
They provide to their employees through a vendor. That one you are saying, through a contractor.
Yeah. So they take services from contractor and they pay. So one of my clients, their monthly invoice is running to almost 1 crore for catering.
Wow. No credit.
No credit for that.
Okay.
So that is one major. And then you won't get credit for any activity done for construction of immovable property.
Achha.
Let us say there is a unit which is built, a factory unit. So credit will not be available for that. The tax paid on that. Same with works contract, credit is not available. Credit is not available for life insurance for employees.
Okay.
Credit is not available if you pay any membership fees for any club, etc. So there is this list of services on which credit is not available.
Not available.
For everything else, credit is available, but you have to give your GST number.
You have to?
Give your GST number.
Right. And basically, to you have to register also, and then you have to start paying your tax, and then you can get your credit.
And you also have to give your GST number to your service provider.
Yeah.
Because if he is not uploading your data on website in his return, it will not match, and you will not get the credit.
Say this again.
So there is this matching concept in GST. So let us say if you are taking any services from me, I will raise an invoice to you. You will pay the tax to me. Mm-hmm. Okay. I will upload these details in my returns in the GST portal.
Yeah.
This is my sales details. You will upload the same details as your purchase on the GST portal.
Yeah.
Until and unless this two match, you will not be able to take the credit. So you have to ensure that I am filing accurate returns and I am also making payment of tax.
Both parties have to ensure that for the other.
Yes. But the purchaser is more concerned because his credit, he has already made the payment to the supplier and he is not getting the credit.
Okay.
So the receiver becomes like a recovery officer of the government.
Purchaser becomes that, right?
Yes.
He has to pursue the supplier.
Yes. To file returns on time, to file accurate returns, and to make that payment of tax. The government officer ke paas kuch kaam nahi bachne wala hai. Iske baad. Right. Sab apne ko karne ka.
Right. Okay. Anything you would like to say about input tax credit when assets are used for personal and business use?
So you can take proportional credit. So there is a set formula for that. How to divide it? You will have to apply that formula and reverse the credit for the personal use that you have done.
Okay. And apart from the credit, are there exemptions and refunds and rebates that are available?
Yeah. Under GST? So there are a lot of exemptions which are there. So there is a list of services like, there is no GST on healthcare services. There is no GST on educational services. if provided by an institute, etc. So there is a list of exempted services and exempted goods. There is no GST on milk, there is no GST on vegetables, etc.
Right.
So there is that huge list, and refund is also available, barring few instances where refund is not available.
Refund in which case is available? What do you mean by refund? Like it's credit or what?
No. So credit is what you use against your tax liability.
Correct.
Refund is something which comes to your bank account from government.
And that is okay. And that is with respect to net credit or something. Achha, you will have to tell me. Can't get it.
So refund will come in which scenario?
Yeah, which scenario?
First of all, two major scenarios when someone is into heavy exports.
Yeah.
So export and supply to SEZ is under zero, is known as zero rated supply.
Right.
So when I am doing an export, I am not required to pay any tax because I am doing something good for the country, you know, foreign exchange is coming in. So when I am doing any export, I am not required to pay any tax. But for doing this export, I have taken services. Right. I have also procured goods. So I have paid tax on these services. I have paid tax on these goods.
Right.
So my credit is getting accumulated over here.
Right.
And I'm not paying any tax over here, or I'm not liable to pay any tax over here. So how do I utilize this credit? Okay. So for that, what government says is that we understand that you will not be able to utilize this credit. So you can take this credit as a refund, which we will give you in your bank account.
Okay.
So export generally will come under these circumstances. And there will be some rare instances where tax on output goods or output services will be less than tax on input goods or input services. So for example, what I am using, taking as input, I am paying tax on it as 18%. But the output liability is at 5%.
Can you repeat, please? It got stuck.
So there will be rare instances where tax on input will be higher and tax on output will be lesser. So I'm paying tax at the rate 18% in input, but my liability is coming at the rate 5%.
Right.
So there will be accumulation in this case as well. apply for refund in such scenarios as well.
Got it. And what are the major returns to be filed, and should any registers be maintained for GST?
Yeah, so I will take you through the returns. I'm sharing the screen once again. Yeah. So this is how you, this is the process of filing the returns. So basically you are supposed to upload 3 returns every month.
Okay.
So on 10th, you are supposed to upload GSTR1. So in GSTR1, you will give details of all your outward supplies.
Okay.
That is all the sales that you have done.
Right.
Now similarly, everyone would have filed by 10th, GSTR1 by 10th, correct?
Right.
So let us say now I'm a purchaser and I have got 5 suppliers. So they would have filed their GSTR1 details of their supplies.
Right.
By 10th. On 11th, I will be able to download the filings that they have done against my GST number.
Right.
This download will be known as GSTR2A.
Right.
Now, they have this, this is the data as filed by my suppliers,
right?
Okay, but abhi isme kafi baar apni country mein aisa hoga ki supplier ka accountant bimar ho gaya, ya supplier ka accountant ka shaadi hai, shaadi hai to wo usne return bhulna bhul gaya, theek hai? So how do I ensure, how do I ensure that all my purchases are there in that system or not?
Right.
So I will have to run a reconciliation between my records and the records uploaded by my purchaser.
Okay.
I will have to rectify if there is any rectification which is required to be done, and then I will have to upload GSTR 2 by 15th.
Hmm.
After that, so as of now, till now I have filed GSTR 1 by 10th. Now I have filed GSTR 2 by 15th. Okay.
Right.
Now once again, now I'm a supplier. Okay. So let us say I had forgotten something in my GSTR 1 by 10 that I filed on 10th.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So yeh mera purchaser ne pakad liya. Okay, boss, this is the mistake that you did. I'm correct. Adding that invoice and you please check.
Hmm.
So if there is any addition or modification done by my purchaser, I will be able to look at it in GSTR 1A, which will be available on 16th and 17th.
Hmm.
Now I have the power to accept or reject that modification.
Right.
So I will do so, and I will file GSTR 1A by 17th.
Right.
After that, after all these filings, GSTR 3 will be generated.
Hmm.
This will be automatically generated. I will have to give details of the payment of taxes that I have done. And then finally, the process is over on 20th.
This has a lot of manual work involved. Huh? There'll be so much dispute, this, that. So one person will have to do just GST work.
Correct. That is why I said in the beginning that you will have to see the cost benefit analysis of taking a registration vis-a-vis how much credit you are losing.
Yeah.
And now chartered accountants are not, are not allowed to marry anyone between 10th and 20th, to go on any holiday between 10th and 20th, because they have to be in their offices filing returns for everyone.
Got it. Okay.
So, well, I guess we have covered most of our points regarding impact on property related dealings. As I said in the beginning, real estate is out of GST. However, if you are buying it from the developer or builder himself,
mm-hmm.
and if you are paying any amount before completion certificate,
mm-hmm.
then GST will be levied. After that, GST is not levied on it.
No, so many of the under construction projects are, you have to pay before the completion certificate. No?
Yes, so GST will be levied on that.
Paid.
Yeah, so GST has to be paid on the GST has to be paid on the whole amount.
Whole amount? Well, no, whatever amount was paid before completion certificate.
No,
that's usually whole the whole amount.
The whole amount. Even for the amount which will be paid after completion certificate.
Acha. So there you are paying this also. Stamp duty also. And GST.
Yes.
So people won't want to buy this thing, no? Under construction flats. First to demonetization, ruined real estate. Now GST will give a death blow to it.
No, but there were similar provisions in service tax and VAT as well. So as far as prices are concerned, it should not make a major difference.
Okay. And secondary sales on real estate will not have GST.
It will not have GST.
Okay. Only stamp duty.
Yeah.
And anything you want to share about the import-export transactions? Sorry, we've crossed past our time, but this is the last question.
Yeah, so import-export transactions, if you're doing any import, it is an indirect transaction. You have to pay IGST on that.
Yeah.
The for goods, it is CVD and SAD has been replaced by GST. So the process remains the same. You have to discharge your liability when you file bill of entry. For import of services.
But how are we having GST over the? See, we had normal import duty and a few other duties over the import duty earlier under the customs law. So GST is replacing which duties over that?
CVD and SAD.
Special additional duty and countervailing duty.
Yes.
Okay, and that is IGST which is replacing them.
Correct.
Okay. Is there a rate difference or something?
Rate difference for what?
IGST vis-a-vis CVD and...
No, it will depend on the product.
SAD.
Achha, vis-a-vis CVD and SAD? Yes, definitely. So, I think it was different for... CVD was like 12.5% and SAD was like 4%. Now, it will depend on the product.
Okay.